Hey everybody, just let your light shine. And we are at the Howe Waffle House because we're going to do the Santa Ana Ghost Tour Walk.
Yeah, it's going to be great.
Yeah, and I want to, this awesome music, but I want to show you why it has, because it's got skeletons with candles on top. That's why. So we're kind of early, so we're just hanging out in the patio backside of the house. This is the same place that we did that Justin Scard meetup. So we're just gonna have a seat right here. Just noticed the flickering chandelier. It's pretty cool. So I'm hoping this will take okay at night, and I apologize if the quality of video isn't as great.
Tour of downtown Santa Ana. My name is Tina, and I'm going to be very happy to be your tour guide tonight. I'm going to take you through an enchanted city. Santa Ana is 128 years old, and you can't have anything that's that old without having energies left over from what these buildings and places used to be. So, this is the tour that you won't find in the AAA brochures. So, a little bit about haunted Orange County and the marvelous investigators that have investigated every one of the stops I'm going to take you on. Haunted Orange County is unique in the tour industry because everything I tell you on this tour is real. I could make it up, oh boy, could I make up good stories, but we don't do that. And I'm sure we've all been on ghost walks where you think, wow, that's a great story, I sure hope it's true. Everything I tell you tonight is true. Ernie has a team of three investigators, three psychics that go with him on all of his tours, and they are marvelous, intriguing, wonderful people. They look just like you and I. But when they go into their mode, they have a sense that you and I don't have, and they are the real thing. Now, I happen to be with the society that takes care of this house. Our phone rings probably once a month at least with people claiming to be psychics, and they want to come and rent the house so they can do a reading. And they're some of the biggest crackpots you've ever met, I'll tell you right now. Ernie's investigators are welcome in this house at any time. They're respectful, they're honest, they're very well matched. The three of them are very well matched. And they have investigated here many, many times. They're going to do it again. Ernie is hosting another sleepover event here in the house. This, I think, will be his third one. They've been very successful and very interesting. So that's something to look forward to.
Hey, we are now on our walking tour. That's our lady leading us the way.
Yes. You live and I'm walking with you.
So it's Civic Center Drive and Sycamore Street. Are the streets. That's how Waffle House is located. We're at the courthouse now.
Hey, this is gonna be fun.
Yeah.
It was built in 1903 when Santa Ana became the county seat. That was a big, big deal. Oh, it looks gorgeous all lit up at night. You get a chance to go in there. This is the parking lot for it. Go in, wander, walk around, they'll let you see everything. Santa Ana History Room up on the third floor, absolutely gorgeous. So, here we are, and like I mentioned, this is the parking lot for the courthouse. We have parking meters and blacktop and landscaping and all this and that and the other thing. But if you look down at your feet, where we're standing, you're gonna see these little pavers look rather out of place. Why are they here? Where's our blacktop? And then if you look around here, there's some little funny looking little outcroppings. They're way down there. There's a few more in the corners. And there's one right over there. Little outlines. Mm-hmm. So why do you suppose they left this little footprint?
we are standing.
Okay. Well, there was something there. We are standing in the footprint of Santa Ana's second jail.
Oh.
This is where the jail was.
Wow.
And it was affectionately called Lacey's Hotel because Theo Lacey, Sheriff Theo Lacey, was the sheriff in charge of the universe. He was the sheriff in Santa Ana for many, many years. And yes, the same Theo Lacey that our current jail is named after is right across the street there in the Civic Center. So, Lacey's Hotel. The Lacey's family, he and his wife and children, lived on the third floor. And Mrs. Lacey made all the food for the inmates. It all sounds like Mayberry RFD kind of. Sound is kind of charming. And remember though, no cars, no street lights, no none of that. Horses, just dirt roads and horses and that type of thing. This was a growing... Someone came to the society about a year ago.
Apparently that was a catwalk from prison.
Hey, my great-grandfather was one of the workmen that worked on this courthouse, and after the 33 earthquake, he took home three big stones from there. Would you guys like them? Well, of course we did, and they're in the garden of the Waffle House, and I'll show those to you when we get back.
Oh, cool.
So why are we standing in the outline of Santa Ana's second jail? Unfortunately, it's not haunted. I'm very sorry. I wish it was. It's not haunted. But the building across the street sure as boys is. Ooh, there it is, folks.
Did you take swimming lessons there?
Did you take swimming lessons there?
Yeah.
Do you know that pool's still there?
Really?
Oh, yes, indeedy weedy.
We're going to go in there?
No, we're not, unfortunately. But Ernie got in there.
Oh, he did.
Now, there's three people. I'm still looking for our missing folks. I feel so bad. I've never had anybody just plain old-fashioned not show up.
I want to have a watch.
So, yeah, there was this, where this bricks are different right there, is a catwalk from the courthouse straight to the jail. But now there's no jail, so there's no catwalk.
If ever a building was haunted, that is it. That's the site of Santa Ana's YMCA. Now, the elementary school was right next door. They moved to more modern facilities, larger facilities, and the YMCA moved in here and started to build. Now, back in the early 1900s, the YMCA was a great place for people to stay, for men to stay. Because remember, they had horse and buggies, horse and wagons, they had their feet. Going somewhere was a journey. Just to get to San Diego and back, or from San Diego to LA, ooh, it took forever. So if a young man is going along, or a traveling salesman, we've all heard the jokes, if they wanted to stay overnight and still keep their reputation intact, they would rent a room at the YMCA, Young Men's Christian Association, and everyone would think he was a saint because he stayed there. Okay, so the YMCA was a very vital part of every city that they came into. They had all sorts of activities. It was like a community center almost. And of course they had the Bible study there. Downstairs is a great big pool. The organization Toastmasters began in that very building. First meeting ever was organized in that building. So, long time later on, it was the YMCA forever and a day. When they moved out, because the building is very big and I'm sure very hard to maintain, they moved out. The sheriff's department used that building as a training facility for its rookies. They played cops and robbers in there and they have destroyed it. Sat vacant for many, many years, and hooray, St. Joseph's Hospital has purchased the building and they're just ripping it all of its inside. And they've been blocked off for years, and I said, come on, Ernie, what have you got on somebody let you in there? Okay, so he gets permission to come in here with the three investigators and all the equipment that goes with an investigation. And if you ever get a chance to go with him, I know he's limiting that by quite a bit now. He gets a lot of requests, but if you ever get a chance to go on an investigation, take it. It's amazing. And his three investigators always do the same thing. They did it at the Waffle House, they do it everywhere. Don't tell us anything. Don't tell us anything, don't guide us anywhere, just let us wander. So they get turned loose in this great big building and they wandered. They went into that sixth sense that you and I don't have, and at the end of this session, they all get together and they discuss what they've found. Right over here, right next to this palm tree, right around this two-window area, they found something very chilling. They found something desperate, desperate and in agony. This building was never haunted until the 1950s. When one man who was renting a room there was brutally hacked to death by two other residents there, all for his social security check. That's all they wanted. They took the man's life right there. All three investigators found this agony, couldn't quite pin down the area, but right in there by those windows. Now all those little windows are little rooms. They're very small rooms that people would rent for a week or a day or they need it. So they found that exact little hot spot, but while they were in the building, they found something they didn't expect to find. They found the spirit of a little girl downstairs in the basement at the poolside. She's not in agony, she's not in terror or any kind of agony of any kind. She has her hands behind her back. She's walking up and down the long length of the pool, and she's looking down into where the water used to be. She's at peace, she's there, and try as we could not find any record of a little girl who drowned there or had been killed in the building at all. We couldn't find it, so I'll just be up front, on the front side.
Yeah, it's really cool.
So there it is, our gorgeous courthouse. As I mentioned, built in 1903. And here's how it looked back when it was built in 1903.
Ooh.
There it is.
Now, there's a top part.
Oh, there's something missing today.
Oh, yeah.
Something missing. Yeah, time capsule's still here.
One of those Smokey Joe, exactly.
1933, we had a little trouble in Long Beach called the Long Beach earthquake. Here's what we had after the earthquake. Oops. Isn't that something, right where we're standing?
Wow.
Now, the bell tower was severely damaged and had to be taken down. Unfortunate. Downstairs in the basement. They don't like to go in there. They get this feeling of dread. They get this terrible funky feeling they can't explain. They don't want to go in there, and they don't go in there by themselves. So Ernie runs over to the city archives, where one of our folks works, says, "Hey, Chris, let me see the blueprints." Okay, they spread out the blueprints and find that that was a holding cell for not the people that could go over in Lacey's hotel. No, that's right, the parking lot. These were the people that were violent. They were the criminally insane people. One man named Joseph Schmidt brutally strangled. In fact, he broke his neck. Another inmate that was in that holding cell with him. So this big, beautiful courthouse, as beautiful as it is, it has its dark secrets. And that's why it's on a ghost walk. Let's go see what else we can find. Mm-hmm.
Oh, there is like stairs.
I may stop speaking to let the traffic go by. If you don't hear something, please let me know. Now, of all the things around us, which building do you suppose is haunted?
That one.
Oh, maybe that one?
Schizophrenic, what made them hear voices, what made them so darn depressed, He was very, very good. He did lots of wonderful research. He was so good at it that he was asked to become the director of the San Jose Insane Asylum. Yes, I don't think they call it that anymore, but back in the day they did. He spent many years up there being their director, and when his time there was finished, he came back here to this house. Spread out just right. And he continued his research and he saw his patients. One night his wife called him to dinner. He was reclining on a little settee in his living room. He started to get up from the settee, grabbed his chest and had a massive heart attack and died here in his home. So his wife said, well, there's no reason for me to stay here anymore. I'm gonna go live with the kids. And she did. And of course, she sells this magnificent home to the Smith Tuttle Mortuary. Okay. And it was the Smith Tuttle Mortuary up until about 8 years ago. And when I was a little kid, we would beg my mother to drive past this building and then we'd all shrink away and go, because it would, here's a picture of the house, and note the trees. I love these pictures. Tell the time frame on the trees.
The lady's standing in the window.
Uh-huh. How cool are these old pictures? I love these things.
Oh, wow, yeah.
So there it is. Smith Tuttle Mortuary. Yes. City Bank, can I come in here with my investigators and read the house? And they said, absolutely not. So he interviews the employees of the bank. And he says, hey employees, without leading them on, he says, hey employees, is there anything odd about this building that you can tell me about? And they said, oh God, yes. Second story. Employees said there's something bizarre on the second floor up here. Something so bizarre that we do not go up there by ourselves. We don't even go up there in pairs. We go in little groups of threes. It was all records retention, file cabinets and the storage and all of that. They'd run up there, they'd get what they need and get the heck out of there because they would have this terrible feeling that something was gonna get them. It was a gripping feeling is what they described it as. So Ernie goes down to another city bank and he interviews employees that had transferred out of that bank. They told him the same stories. Okay, second story here was the embalming room. Rather quickly back then because things deteriorated and people had to come long distances for funerals. So they had to get people prepared pretty quickly. Back in that day, back in the early 1900s, Victorians were very, very scared of being buried alive. There was a very good reason for that. Medical technology was not what it is today. Every once in a while, you hear about that happening now, that little baby that fell in the icy water is down in the morgue, and when she warmed up, she came back to life. Every once in a while, you hear about it, but you heard about it a lot back then. Every once in a while, someone was brought into an old mortuary like this, prepared for burial. They were still alive and couldn't tell anybody. I can't even imagine that would be an unthinkable horror. So it's not unique to this old mortuary to have spirits left in there for a very, very good reason. These things happen. One person who was terribly afraid of that happening to him was Edgar Allan Poe. And he wrote about it again and again and again. People talking colas.
I know the traffic.
describes it as a catalytic state. And 2 years ago, we usually have an evening with Edgar Allan Poe here at the house. It's marvelous. Don't miss it. Tonight, I hope I can get to the other stop. This building I'm going to tell you about once we get back to the Waffle House, because it's just, there's nothing really to see. It's just a great story. So I'll tell you about that when we get back. And we're going to have to run around the block and see if we can get to that should have been toward the end of the tour. We are standing at what used to be Santa Ana's Masonic Lodge. Anyone here know a Mason?
Yeah, used to.
Anybody, a grandfather?
Used to be a Mason funeral.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, my dad had one too. This was my dad's lodge when he was alive. This was my dad's lodge. The building is absolutely spectacular. It's not spectacular, it's opulent inside. They spared no expense on this Masonic hall. Now, if you know a Mason, if you have someone in your family, a grandfather, a great-grandfather, you know what that means to a man. It's something they hold very near and dear. It's a very honored title. Be a Mason, they're good, upstanding people. They help everyone. They go on, they split out into different branches. The Shriners, you've heard of the Shriners Hospital. They treat children for free. Unbelievable group. It means so much to a man that this building, and I could tell you stories about the one in Fullerton too. Boy, is it haunted. Wow. Most Masonic halls of this age are had inhabited. There's paranormal. Because it means so much to a man to be a Mason, that after a man passes on, his soul often goes back and resides in his Masonic hall. So, another tour guide, Charles, used to do this tour. Now he does one in Orange as well. He's a Mason. And before this was the Church of Scientology, he and Ernie came into this building very respectfully, and they did their investigation very quickly, very low key. And what they found from this building is not unlike what they found in other Masonic halls all across the United States. When the hall doors, when the ritual room doors are closed, you can still hear the sounds of men reciting their promises of what they're going to do and what they're going to be and how they're going to act. They recite their rituals. And they started again and again. You can hear it like a record player skipping in time. It's very, very common all across the United States in all Masonic halls of this age. So when the Masons sold this building, they moved to a smaller building. And they was purchased by the Church of Scientologists. Okay, the Waffle House is right down the street, right next door. When they started to renovate this building, we were all over them like a bad suit. We didn't let up on them. We took turns looking through the construction dumpsters at night. And they swore that they were going to be responsible. And in their defense, they have been very responsible in the restoration of this building. About the best advice I can give you is don't go in. They will try. Don't go in. Do not give them your name. They will find you, and I don't care how far they have to go. And there were about 12 of us. We almost didn't get out of the building. I'm not joking. Go in there. I'm sure what they do is fine, but their tactics a little forceful. But anyway, here's our Masonic hall. Yes, there's spirits in there. There's spirits in there for a very good reason. The one in Fullerton is so inhabited by spirits that there's actual apparitions all over that building. It's just a lot.
Onward to the next destination. It's pretty wild here at night, the old Santa Ana town.
Let's see, I'm coming over here. And I'll try and really, really speak up. I'm so sorry, folks. Oh, boy.
Cockroach friend.
Okay. We're just going to do the very best we can. That's what we're going to do. I'm glad it was not a group of 30 people. Ah!
Oh.
Wow.
He keeps just...
No.
Nice. He wants to be part of it.
Gosh, if we had saddles, we could throw me random out? Holy shamoles.
Nice.
Okay, we're going to do the very best we can. Welcome to the heartbeat of Santa Ana. Most cities have Main Street as their main street. And we have a main street too. It's right over there. But the heartbeat of Santa Ana is 4th Street. We braved everything today. The heartbeat of Santa Ana is 4th Street. And you hear about it on the news. So-and-so this and that on 4th Street. Festival this and that on 4th Street. Everything that happens in Santa Ana happens here on 4th Street. And if you can just imagine, you passed all the noise, all the modern things. Imagine this street when it was the early 1900s. When this city was just emerging. And see, here's the nice part about a walking tour. You can see the facades of the buildings. Some of them have not changed in all that time. This one over here has, but this one hasn't, and so on and so forth. The building next door is Woolworths, and so on and so forth. The poor little 4th Street, it's not without its tragedies. The building across the street is the Spurgeon Building, built by William Spurgeon, the man who founded Santa Ana. And the Waffle House is very happy to have one of the original clock bands. It's above the piano, so you can see that when we get back to the house tonight. Unfortunately, that building isn't haunted. Isn't that a stinker? I tell you, I wish it would be probably a butcher and a grocer and all these things. The building that we're standing opposite of, you'll see, looks quite different. It has the columns and capitals. It has some brave lions up here in the top and a tile roof, and it has a flagpole. It looks very strong. It looks very important. And it stands out. Now that you see it, it stands out from the other buildings. Now remember, basements, even these streets, tunnels, basements, everybody. We are standing in front of Santa Ana's first jail. Very first jail was right there in that basement. And upstairs was some police offices, then they did the business of policing and all of that. And again, it's Sheriff Theo Lacey. He's in charge of the world.
It's not of the
time. Now, Theo had gone through some bad scrapes. And his reputation had taken a couple of hits because that poor little ill-fitted jail had been broken out of, sometimes by the same inmate twice. Round him up and put him back in there. True story. And once it was broken into, and someone stole all the pillows and blankets from the cells. So everybody's laughing. Ha ha, Theo, you can't keep your man. Ha ha ha. And he's doing the slow burn. Boy, he wishes he had something to redeem himself with. And he found it in this gentleman, Francisco Torres. He did a bad thing and Theo caught him. Francisco worked as a ranch hand on a very big ranch in what's now Lake Forest. The ranch was owned by Madame Helena Majeska. Does anybody know her? She owned the entire Majeska Canyon. And she loved this area. She was a very, very famous Polish lady. She was an actress, a Shakespearean actress. She does. Her home is still in Majeska Canyon. You can make an appointment and take a tour through it. It's a must-see. It's a miser on her ranch. One day he gets his paycheck and he's short $2.50. That was an awful lot of money back then. So he goes to the supervisor and he says, "Supervisor, what did I do? What did I do wrong?" And he said, "Nothing. Everybody has to pay this. It's a poll tax. Anybody that has a job has to pay this tax." Oh, God, Francisco is devastated. He goes and he gets dead drunk. And he comes back and he argues with the supervisor again. And again, the supervisor says, "Nothing I can do for you. This is the way that it is." So Francisco is outraged. He's so outraged, he goes to the shed, picks up a pickaxe, comes back at the supervisor and buries it in his brain. Then he flees for his life and he gets very close to the Mexican border and the San Diego Police Department picked him up. They called up Theo and said, "Theo, we've got your man. Come on down and get him." But whatever you do, do not bring him back to Santa Ana. He's never going to get a fair trial. Everybody deserves one. He'll never get one. So what do you suppose Theo does? He's going to be the big shot for sure. He hooks up his horse and his wagon, goes down to San Diego and personally picks him up. Where do you suppose he brought him? At a slow walk, right down 4th Street. Right down here with everybody cheering him. Theo, yay, our sheriff, our great sheriff. Ha ha ha. Deposits him in this jail. Next day, they pick him up and his court-appointed attorney at the courthouse. Court-appointed attorney says, Judge, you got to get us out of here. You have to have a change of venue here. You must rule for one. He's never going to get a fair trial. And the judge said, denied. So they put him back in the jail at night, and they're going to prepare for the trial the next day. The wee hours of the morning, a big group of citizens from Santa Ana came to that jail yelling, we want Torres. Open the door. And the jailer is there. He's trying to plead for calm. They're having no calm. Francisco is screaming for help. They overpower him, open the cell, and drag him, screaming and kicking, across the street to that corner. They threw a rope over the telegraph poles, and they hanged him right where those folks are standing. And while his body was still writhing in the death agonies, they pinned a note on his body that said, change of venue. And no one was ever indicted for the murder of Francisco Torres.
It's kind of creepy.
Episode that featured the Yost and the Waffle House? Good. It's been years and we're still mad at them. They came downtown to investigate the Yost Theater. They called Ernie ahead of time and said, hey Ernie, is there anything else we should see in Santa Ana? And he said, oh yeah, come over to the Waffle House. We got approval. They paid us lots of money for that. By the time they got us on television, they misrepresented us all over the place. We're still mad at them, and I don't care if they came back with a bundle of money, they are not welcome in the house anymore. But anyway, the owner of the Yost Theater, when this theater was first built, it was the Auditorium Theater. Then it became the Clumes Theater, and then it became the Yost Theater when Mr. Yost bought it. Back in the old Hollywood days, believe it or not, that theater was the place to be. Clark Gable and Carol Lombard would come here just to see new acts that were going on. Everyone in Hollywood wanted to be invited to play at the Yost. And of course, it was all live entertainment, no movies, anything like that. It was vaudeville. You could pay your money and sit down, and one act after another. One would be a comedian, a juggler, burlesque act. Yes, they had those. But no movies, of course. It wasn't... movies weren't happening then. It was a live venue. But everyone in Hollywood wanted to get the chance to be there at the Yost. The Marx Brothers got their start here. So did Fatty Arbuckle. The Three Stooges got their start here. Lots of different singers, lots of actors and things, including one gentleman named Ernest Ball. Now, before I tell you about Mr. Ball, I'll tell you why this theater Ghost Adventures. The now owner of the theater called them up and said, there is something very, very active in my building and I'd like you to come here and take a look at this. When the manager, when the owner goes to his office, which is upstairs in the back of the theater, which is the design of all theaters, there's lots and lots of little dressing rooms with lots of wooden doors. And as he walks down that hallway, the doorways rattle, and they follow him, drop off behind him, and follow him as he walks. Every once in a while, that happens. So everybody's wondering what in the world is in there. Ernie did his homework. He came with his investigators. They found all sorts of things. And when the Ghost Adventure people got here, one of the staff took Ernie aside and said, "This is one of the scariest places I've ever been in." And these people do this for a living all over the United States. The only person we know of that died in that building was a young Irish gentleman named Ernest Ball. Ernest had absolutely everything going for him. He was darling. He had a beautiful voice. He wrote his own music. Everybody loved him. And look how cute he is. He's in the prime of his life as Ernest Ball. He wrote a little piece of music that everybody knows. He wrote "When Irish Eyes Are Smiling." He did. Here's a picture of it. Ernest R. Ball. So Ernest R. Ball is here at the Yost Theater, and he's going to perform here. Manager knocks on his door and says, "Mr. Ball, 15 minutes. He puts his head back and leans back in his chair, thinking the world has nothing more to offer him. He was right. He had a massive stroke and died in that chair in the Yost Theater. And if I was Ernest Ball, my life was cut short like that, I would haunt the daylights out of wherever it is that I die." So, he's the only one that we know of that's in the Yost Theater. The Yost Theater is now, it's alive with live music venues almost every night of the week. They've done a wonderful job. If you ever get a chance to stop in there, they've done a nice job every month. Okay, so we have the pawn shop. But remember I told you, the city is 128 years old. And these buildings were something much different back then. So, they're much different. People are different. The circumstances are all different. Hi, babies. So Ernie does his homework on these buildings, and he finds out what this building used to be. And he comes over here to the owner of the pawn shop. He's this crusty little, "I've seen it before" kind of guy. And he says, "Hey, crusty little pawn shop owner, do you know what your building used to be?" "No." And he tells him, and the man looks at him and says, "Well, that explains it." Huh. And Ernie says, "What? Explains what?" When the gentleman is at his desk, which is in the basement, and it faces the brick wall, a great big desk, and he's doing all the paperwork for his business, he feels like somebody's there. Okay, now we've all had that experience. God, I feel like somebody's watching me. But he feels it so strongly that if you stand next to your sweetie and you stand real close to them, you can feel that little electricity that we all have. He feels it so strongly that he keeps swatting at the air, and it drives him nuts, and he keeps turning around and looking. And now he doesn't have to turn around and look anymore because he knows what's going on. We are standing in the front of Santa Ana's first mortician, undertaker, coroner, post-mortem photographer, and furniture builder. All in the same building. Yep, he was the carpenter. He made the tables, chairs, cupboards, everything for a growing city. He built coffins. He built lots of coffins. Early 1900s, people died. They died of the darndest things that you hear today with an aspirin. Fairhaven Cemetery has plots of little children's graves. They all got influenza and they died. Today, a few aspirin, drink lots of liquids, off to school the next day. But people died a lot more than they did now. When's the last time you heard of a woman who died in childbirth? Never, maybe once. So these things happened, and death was viewed quite differently than it is today. Today we'd find these things horrifying, but back then these were just the way that it worked. Remember, all dirt roads. People traveling, they had to travel for days to get where they were going, and sometimes they got sick and they died out on the open road. Not everybody knew everybody because they were going here and there and all that. So, this man had to do lots of different tasks for this growing city. He had to be the coroner. If someone died, they drug him over here, and about all he had to do was look at them and say, yep, he's dead. Or they put a little mirror up your nose. If they didn't get any little fuzzy steam, you were in there. And of course you had to be embalmed right away, because if your family was notified of a funeral going on, they had to make quite a journey to get here. So this man had to keep people looking pretty good for maybe a week while people got here for a funeral. He had to pronounce them dead. He had to embalm them to keep them pretty fresh looking. He had to do all of these things. Now, what would happen if someone died and no one knew them? Like it was a traveling person, horse and buggy, and he slumps over, he's gone. They would clean him up the best that they could and make him look presentable. They would put him in a coffin without a lid, and they would prop them up in this window. And I am not making that up. My mom grew up in New Jersey. Her grandmother used to walk her on the other side of the street if someone was in residence in the window. Okay,
wow.
They would prop them up in this window, and there they are. We've all seen those old Western photographs, you know, so-and-so has killed, there he is. And with the hopes that someone would be able to identify this dead person, and then they would notify their next of kin and try to get somebody to come and get him and all of those things. It's all right. Yes, this happened. Now, something else that this gentleman had to do for this community. Photography back then was new. It was new and it was very expensive. You couldn't have a photographer at a child's christening or a birthday party or a wedding. They just were too expensive for people to afford. Has anyone here heard of postmortem photography? You have?
My mom has pictures.
Yeah. If you have your cell phones out, do not rush to look at them. I'm going to warn you, these pictures are gruesome at best. They're pictures of people that are posed with their family members, and they're dead.
Or they're dead. Mm-hmm. They have their eyes painted.
Yes, they do.
God. I've heard about it.
Ew. Yes, they do.
That's creepy.
This gentleman had to do that. He had to make these people look alive. He had to make them look alive long enough for their relatives to get here, pose everybody together to get a picture of them. But what did this man have to do to make these people look pretty good while they got these photographs? He had to be a bit of an artist. Their eyes had to be painted on their eyelids because it's the first thing that goes when someone dies. They would take a child that had died and prop them up with all sorts of racks through the backs of their clothes to keep them in a thing to put their head, and they would have them holding hands with their live siblings. Today we think that's gruesome and horrible, but back then that's just the way that it worked. Don't rush to look at the pictures though, they're not so nice. Ernie has some, and if he's back at the house tonight when we come back to the house, he'll show them to you. He has an advertisement from a company that specialized in making racks to keep people up, and the harnesses and the things to keep people's heads going. But it was needed, it happened. Don't look the photographs up. If you want to sleep, don't do that. It all happened right here in the Jones Jewelry and Loan. So see if these walls could talk. Now, next year we hope to get a second tour of Santa Ana with other things that go down around in this area down here. It's still very safe to go down there, and some of those stories are
so. We're back at the howe-waffle house, which ends our tour.
Can you imagine? The year is 1889, no longer 2017. Coming into the home of Dr. Willella Howe-Waffle. She was Orange County's first woman physician. She specialized in delivering babies, and she delivered over 1,000 babies to this growing community, and this is her home. So when we come on inside, the house is going to be dark. The house is going to be a little dark. Everybody, please stay together.
I guess this was the carriage house.
Thank you.
It smells of old wood.
Do you want the door shut?
Oh, it's all right.
Okay.
Oh, stop.
Don't tell me that. Just be the exterminator. Don't tell me that. Welcome, everyone, to the home of Dr. Willow, a howe-waffle. This marvelous Queen Anne-style house was built in 1889 by Dr. Willella Howe-Waffle and her husband, Dr. Alvin Howe. She was married twice, that's why she has the dual hyphenated last name. The house came from the East. Dr. Alvin Howe was already a physician, and Willella went to school as an element. She went to work as an elementary school teacher in Westminster, till she got enough money to go back to Chicago and got her medical degree. The two of them had this house built and they practiced medicine here in this house. She specialized in delivering babies. She was an amazing lady. Back then in those times, women didn't do things like that. They weren't physicians. They may have been telegraph operators, maybe, if their husband would allow it. But they weren't doctors, they weren't anything else besides that. They just weren't. But she knew she had something to give to the world, and she did it. She was an amazing lady. She was a very benevolent lady. About a year and a half into this house, her husband, Dr. Alvin Howe, was brought up on charges of suspicion of performing an abortion. Back then, that was the worst thing that you could do. But he was found not guilty. But that was enough to ruin his reputation. Rather than dragging his wife's reputation down too, he left this house and went to San Francisco to continue his medical practice. And he was a very good doctor. We all know how those long distance relationships work, and she divorced him about 7 years later. She married Edson Waffle, and he was a great guy. Everybody loved him. He owned the livery stable in town, and he boarded horses, he rented horses, took care of people's carriages and all that. He brought us three children to live with her two children here in this house until she died at the side of a patient not in this house in 1924. This house was saved from destruction. It used to reside across the street in the Burger King parking lot. It was due for demolition, and one dear lady stepped before the city council and said, "Oh no, you don't." And they fought and fought, and finally the city said, "Okay, it's in such bad shape. We'll move it here for you." She formed the Santa Ana Historical Preservation Society. We maintained this house. We restored it from the ground up. They said if it isn't restored in 10 years, it comes down. It's open for tours. Our next tour will be next Saturday, April 1st. And we're open for public tours. We have all sorts of fun things going on in this house. The society, and I'll tell you a little bit about the society, it's relevant. The society is an all-volunteer society. We don't get paid. We open this house for anybody who wants to see it. We're very, very proud of it. We're all level-headed people, mostly. Mm-hmm. We're all volunteers, and the only reason that I tell you that is that we're not kooks, we're not nuts. Almost all of us have experienced something paranormal in this house. And I'll tell you right up front, we are not a haunted house. We are someone's home that has spirits left from all the different lives that this house has played. It wasn't just her house. It was lots of different things. It was a hospital for returning veterans. It was an army headquarters. It was the home of a man that made Venetian blinds, and everyone called him the blind man. Mm-hmm. Not making this up. It's been lots of different things over the years. So what do we experience in this house? There's lots of opportunity for somebody to be in this house after dark. I'm gonna do it tonight when I take down the skulls. I don't have one bit of fear from this house. There's nothing menacing in here whatsoever. Sounds of little running, happy little running feet down the hallway upstairs. Lots of like a little kid running along, little unsteady little bitty feet. Sound followed by something that sounds like a bouncing ball. So we don't know who it is. We only know of one person who died in the carriage barn. No one that we know of died in the house. We just don't have
records like that at all that we could trace at all. We're very sorry about that. But the investigators that have been in this house are Ernie's investigators. They are the real deal. They'll be coming here again when Ernie does his sleepover. They'll be here again. They're welcome in this house at any time. And one of them is a little older gentleman named Don. And Don's all right. He's a very, very funny man. And I was here with them the first time they came to read this house. I was the only one brave enough to sit with this house while they did it. And I said to him, Don, how long have you been doing this? Because he's older. And he said, I guess I've known since I was about 6 or 7. And that's all he'll say. And I thought, what a cool answer. But he's repeatedly drawn to the closet in one of the bedrooms up there. And it's just like a magnet. And he says there's a child in this closet and he's hiding. He's not hiding out of fear, he's hiding out of fun. It's something fun, it's a game. Ernie's, another friend of Ernie's, rents this house from us for a series of workshops, and she'll rent it every Wednesday night for 4 or 5 weeks, I can't remember how many. But Ellen teaches a psychic development workshop here. And usually I'm the one that comes in house sits because I don't live all that far. And it's very, very interesting. And Ellen's a marvelous lady. She's a fifth generation medium. Fifth generation. Well, 5 ladies in her family. And she sees a little boy down at the end of the stairway. And he's hanging there by the post. And he's holding onto the post and looking around. And she sees him so clearly. She knows that he's in a long white nightshirt, like maybe he's supposed to be in bed and he's looking around. And sometimes she comes in here and she'll tell me, I haven't seen the little boy all night. And then other times she'll tell me he was here the minute we came in. And that's all he does. He just stays by there and he just looks, he's just looking around to see what's going on. We, every once in a while, maybe every 6-8 months, we hear the sounds of a metal grating crashing to the floor. There is no metal grating up there that would crash to the floor, but we hear it every once in a while. See what else I can tell you. Family story that was brought to us by one of Willella's relatives. And yes, they walk in on open houses every once in a while. It's really great. She told us the family story of a young girl that came to Willella. And she was very, very pregnant, very near her time. And she said, can you help me? I'm alone in the world. I'm single. I have no family. And I'm going to have this baby. Can you help me? And Willella would take anybody in. She put her in the carriage barn. The carriage barn is original to the house. And it's a split level. There's a big room up there. And it's very, very nice. It's all finished and lovely up there and all. So she housed lots of patients, mothers in waiting and mothers recovering up in there. And she put the young girl there. And the young girl delivered triplets.
Oh, goodness.
They must have been so tiny. No fresh milk, no vegetables. This was a poor girl. And all 3 of those babies lived. And they were adopted out to one family. I know, I mean, that's such a thrilling story. But after a few days, the mother didn't make it. She died, and she died in our carriage barn. Now, one of our board members is a good friend of mine. She's our antiques go-to person. She used to work for Antiques Roadshow. And whenever we get something, we go, well, we don't know what it is. We take it to her. Okay. She had something happen to her upstairs in that carriage barn, and she will not go back there. She will not step in the door of the carriage barn, and she will not talk about it because she's afraid talking about it's going to open that portal again. She said it was terrifying. She's never been so frightened in her life. She won't do it again. Now, the reason I mentioned we're all volunteers and we're not crackpots is just that. Things like that that happened to us. I'm very proud to be the vice president of the society this year. We do lots and lots of good work for historic preservation all over the city. I know a lot about the city, and what I don't know, the other members do. We have members in this society that know every single brick in this city, and they can tell you really other stories that we won't share on the ghost walk because we haven't investigated them. Ernie's group has not. They've been good stories, murders and stabbings. We get a lot of hangings in Santa Ana. It seemed to be the popular mode, but we don't share them with ghost walk because they haven't been substantiated. So at this point, I'm going to turn the lights on and I'm going to let you wander around just the bottom.
So we can see everything.
Did you get any energy orbs yet?
I didn't see any offhand, but when I go home, yeah. It's kind of nice seeing this house without all the people. When we did the meetup, it was so crowded in here. So it's kind of neat to be able to just kind of wander. And... Mm-hmm. Cool piano. Is it in tune? Oh, it is in tune. Cool. Nice parlor style piano. I have one, but it's not as decorative. Stairs. Must be like the mud room or something. It's kind of cool. It's like an indoor patio. Oh, what's that room?
It's the gift shop. There's all kinds of cool stuff in there.
Oh, let me check that out.
And it's art, and you gotta look at the, the room curves. It's really cool.
Okay, quick look. We're not supposed to have this open.
Oh, okay.
Because
oh, wow, that is cool
this
in here.
This isn't a Waffle House event. It's the Haunted Orange County event.
Oh, okay.
Come back next weekend.
How cool.
Oh, yeah. Then we'll just have everything to sell.
This is cool.
The afterlife, or the
post-mortem,
yeah.
Yes.
And, now, the point was that, the whole point of that was...
The whole point of that was you couldn't afford it.
Right.
But you had to when you couldn't afford not to. And someone dies.
Someone dies, and now, hey, this is our last chance.
This is our last chance. We better spring for it now or we're gone. And so that's why postmortem photography was part of it. Nobody ever could afford it.
Right.
But they got to do it together when someone had died.
Yeah. That's why.
But then they had
so
to
then they kind of, they kind of forced it.
Original clock hand. I'm not going to go upstairs, obviously, because we're not allowed to. Okay, guys, this ends our ghost tour. We're back at the Howe Waffle House, and that's it. So... check it out yourself, Santa Ana.
Yeah, it was really fun. You really should try it.
Yeah. Bye. Thanks for